thank you. You just met Sandy Lygren. She's our program coordinator for Deaf Studies in Division 1, and I'm Julie Jovan-Krozik. I'm a learning specialist out of Disability Services and also a coordinator of services for our deaf and hard of hearing faculty and students. And today we are co-sponsoring this Deaf Awareness Week event so that we can increase awareness of the diversity of students and adults in the deaf community who have varying degrees of hearing loss and shape our college campus. To start off the event, I'd like to acknowledge and introduce our Vice President of Enrollment and Student Services, Steve Oza, who's just going to say a few words in introduction.
Good afternoon. It is a pleasure for me to be here and a pleasure for me to welcome you to this event on behalf of the college administration. Often when I talk to groups of students or groups of staff or community individuals, I talk about the role that all of the staff here at BCC plays every day. And my staff in Student and Enrollment Services certainly know that one of my guiding principles is that we come to work every day for one purpose. And that purpose is to help students achieve their goals. That's the primary reason why we're here every day. This event, however, and events like this, have a special purpose because, in my opinion, it works two ways. We, those of us who work at the college, by hosting events like this, by having a program as our Deaf Studies program, help students reach their goals. And we all know that for deaf students or for hard of hearing students, reaching their goals presents challenges that the hearing community sometimes doesn't understand or doesn't comprehend or had no knowledge of. So reaching the goals can be a little more difficult. But at the same time, it works in reverse, that holding events like this and having students here who are studying in the field and having students from the deaf community here also helps the college reach its goals. And so I think that's a wonderful two-way street that events like this help to bring about. And as I thought about that, and I thought about sharing just a few words with you today, I thought about dreaming a little bit about what the vision is for Bristol Community College in terms of creating a, I think the term that you, Sandy told me many years ago, was creating a deaf-friendly environment here at Bristol Community College. And I want to read to you just for 1 minute what I see in that vision. Bristol Community College will build upon its rich history as a premier higher education institution serving deaf and hard of hearing people to become the university of first choice for the most qualified, diverse group of deaf and hard of hearing students in the world, as well as hearing students pursuing careers related to deaf and hard of hearing people. Bristol Community College will empower its graduates with the knowledge and practical skills vital to achieving personal and professional success, and in changing local and global communities in which they live and work. Bristol Community College will also strive to become a leading international resource for research, innovation, and outreach related to deaf and hard of hearing people. Now, I said that was Bristol Community College's vision. I actually lied to you. I took that from Gallaudet University. The mission statement of Gallaudet University, which I'm sure many of you know, is one of the leading premier institutions in the world for the deaf and hard of hearing. But as I saw that, I thought about what we have created here at Bristol Community College over the time under the able leadership of the staff who work in these programs. And I thought about events like this that all help to contribute to us also aspiring to those same goals, those same objectives, and having that same vision. And I would venture to say that we've come a long way, that I hope, as I was reading that, a lot of you really saw BCC in that, even though I stole it from Gallaudet University. So that's what I'm thinking about this afternoon as I think about these types of events. I welcome you all here. I'm sure it's going to be a very informative and enjoyable experience. Thank you.
So first I want to thank the students who were willing to put themselves out there today and talk about themselves and their experience. I'm going to tell you the format. We're going to spend about an hour with some guided questions that all students will answer at first, which is about their background. And then after that, we'll ask more pointed questions that might feel personal, and then that's up to the panel to decide if they want to answer that question or not. Please notice we have posters along the back wall that I would like you to look at before you leave today. Those were made by students in the Deaf Culture class that runs in the day currently. And it's sort of a nice segue to what today's about. Many people have assumptions about what it means to be deaf. This typically comes from the media, from the one deaf person they know that they work with that's in their family. And so we hope you leave today understanding that the term deaf is an umbrella term for a lot of different types of identities in adulthood. And that knowing one deaf person because they were your coworker or a peer in a class or in your class doesn't mean the next time you meet a deaf or hard of hearing person, you know all the answers and what you're supposed to do. We hope you get challenged today in some of your assumptions by hearing what they have to say. We also will have about 30 minutes of Q&A time for the audience. Please know that that's also teachable moment time. So if you ask a question that you're curious about, but Julie and I feel is insensitive, although that's not how you're meaning to be, we're going to joke with you, we're going to change the question, and we're going to get you to the information you need, but we're also going to be modeling how you talk about some of these things you're curious about. What is appropriate to ask a deaf or hard of hearing person, and what you shouldn't ask a deaf or hard of hearing person, because it's personal and none of your business. We hope that you leave with just a little bit of changed assumption and some new knowledge. And more importantly, don't put your eyes down to the sidewalk and turn the other way when you notice there's a deaf student coming your way, which is a typical experience. So, we're going to start with introductions. I would like each panelist to tell the audience your name, what your major is, when you came to BCC, what your future career goal is looking like, and where you're from.
My name is Alex O'Neill. I'm a communication major here at BCC. I came here in fall of 2011, and my ultimate goal is to be a newspaper columnist.
Oh, name, major, where you're from.
My name is Heather McDonald, and I'm majoring in
We have to figure out. We can't hear you, so we're going to figure it out.
My name is Adam Richard, and I grew up in Acushnet, and I came to BCC in the spring of 2011, and I'm majoring in graphic design. That's it. My name is James Dugas, and I came to BCC in the fall of 2009. My major is fine arts. And after graduation, my goal is to set up an art studio in New Bedford, in the New Bedford area. My name is Jose Pavo, and I started here in the fall of 2011. My major is Deaf Studies and Human Services, and my goal is to graduate and work in human services among people in the deaf community. Hi, my name is Josh Sandoval, and I'm majoring in management, and I started a year ago in the fall of 2011. This is my second year here, and my goal is to transfer to Gallaudet University and become a manager at a gym. My name is Jessica Wardell, and my major is early childhood education. I'd like to work with deaf children. Oh, what was the next question? Where are you from? What are your goals? Oh, what's next? I forgot. And I grew up in Fall River, and I've been here since 2009, so this is my fourth year here. Oh, one thing I forgot to add. I grew up in Chicago, Illinois, and I moved here a year ago.
Okay, my next question for everyone is, could you please tell the audience what label you use to describe yourself? Are you deaf? Are you hard of hearing? Are you hearing? Are you some other label? Could you tell the audience what label you prefer that you call yourself and others call you? We'll start at the beginning again.
I identify as hard of hearing.
Big D deaf. I'm deaf. I'm deaf as well. I'm deaf, and I'm deaf.
So now I'd like to ask you about accommodations. Can you describe what type of accommodations you tend to use to access information either in school, at work, or at home? And if those accommodations also include body-aided accommodations or equipment?
Most of my accommodations are scripture, which includes seed print and closed captioning on TVs.
I am also using seed print.
Well, I use every accommodation that's available. Interpreters, I have used CART a few times. And closed captioning on the television. I don't have any equipment that I use, implants or hearing aids. For accommodations, I use sign language interpreters, and sometimes I need C-print. Of course, when I watch TV, closed captioning. And I use a video phone to communicate. I use sign language interpreters. And just as they said, video phones, and I use texting and on my iPhone, and note takers, CART as well. I use sign language interpreters, and sometimes I have C-print. Most of the time when I watch TV, it's with closed captioning. I use a video phone and I text. Most of the time I use interpreters and note takers, as well as C-print, and I use a video phone to communicate with friends. I use VRS as well, video interpreting services over the video phone, and texting, and closed captioning.
Let me just follow up. If you use a hearing aid, can you talk about how effective it is and why you use it? If you don't use a hearing aid, can you tell us why not? If you use a cochlear implant, can you tell us how effective it is and why you use it and how you use it? If you don't have an implant, can you tell us why or why not?
I use a cochlear implant. I was implanted in 2003. It's hard to gauge exactly how much it helped me here because I have nothing to really compare it to. But percentage-wise, if I have 100% total hearing loss, my implant, according to my audiologist, helps me hear about 60%.
I don't need anything but my eyes to rely on somebody in my lips and communicate.
Well, I did have hearing aids when I was little, and then when I was older, I felt like I was just hearing the same thing. It really wasn't, there wasn't any real difference between the noises. It was just all noise and sound. So I took them off. And since then, I haven't used them. And I still have a little bit of hearing in my left ear. I have hearing aids as well. They're brand new. I got them last summer. and it's a lot of noise, and sometimes I feel like I need to take them off so that it's nice and quiet. All the noise can be distracting. Maybe I need to focus on something, so I don't wear them. I do like to wear them when I listen to music. Hearing some environmental noise or being outside, but here at school, I don't use them. But at home, I do wear the hearing aids. And I need them to communicate with my daughters. And sometimes I hear, but not all the words, but I can also lip read and wear the hearing aids at the same time, and that helps. When I was small, I had this machine, and it was a box on my chest with little earplugs, and it never worked, and the teacher would call on me, and I never heard anything. I was totally deaf, so I removed that, and they kept putting it on my chest, and I kept removing it, and I tried to destroy it, and then I got hearing aids, and they did not work, obviously, and it was like this scratching noise in my ears. I got rid of those, and I like the quiet. I like it. I never use any assistive devices. I was born able to hear, and I became deaf at the age of 2, lost all my hearing, and when we went to the audiologist, the audiologist suggested hearing aids, and I wore them for about 2 years, and I became frustrated, because if anyone yelled, then I got a headache from all the noise, so I turned them on and off, and I was like, you know, you need to fix these, there's something wrong with them, but finally I just decided not to use them, and I haven't used them ever since. I was born deaf, and then when I was about 5 months old, my mother tried to make some sounds and noticed I wasn't hearing. My sister was reacting, but I wasn't. So they brought me to the hospital and found out that I am deaf. That was disappointing for them. And I got hearing aids when I was 10 months old, but I couldn't hear anything. It was just muffled sounds, and I would cry all the time. And then when I grew up, I got rid of the hearing aids. I decided not to use them. And my family is all can hear. And I was curious about sounds and noise, and I put the hearing aids on, and it was an interesting experience, but most of the time I did not use them because it was a muffled sound, and I couldn't understand what they were saying, it was just noise. I got rid of them, and my mother has been encouraging me to get a cochlear implant, but I refuse to get one. I'm proud of being deaf and who I am.
And to follow up and to clarify for the audience, what I'm hearing is that for those of you who have used hearing aids, they made you aware of sound, but it didn't make speech understandable.
That's
so
right.
There wasn't a benefit there.
That's right. Yep.
Okay. And the reason I'm reiterating that is because often hearing people think of hearing aids like glasses. It's blurry and I can't read. I'm going to put on glasses. Oh, now I can see. And that's not how hearing aids work. And as you heard from Alex, that's not even how the implant works. He's aware of sound, he has 60% access of what's going on, but it takes a lot of work to learn to understand what you're hearing through an implant or through hearing aids. So thank you for sharing that. I have a question for the panel, and this is for whomever would like to answer. You don't all have to answer if you don't want to, but I certainly welcome you all to answer if you want to. Are you the only deaf or hard of hearing person in your family? If so, when do you first remember realizing you were different than your family? And raise your hand if you want to answer so we have order.
Okay. I am the only deaf person in my family. There are some people who became deaf later in life from old age, but I'm the only one who was born deaf. When I was born, I felt like I was like everyone else because almost my entire family signs, and out in the real world, not a lot of people were signing, but it really didn't bother me.
Anyone else? Alex?
Well, I'm backtracking a little bit, but my parents found out that I was that I had no hearing when I was 2 years old, and immediately after they found out, they had me fitted for hearing aids. So I went through this whole process of trial and error, which led me to the implant. But I immediately, well, study at the age of 5 when I could comprehend what was going on around me. That's when I noticed that I was different because growing up I had those childhood friends that lived down the street. I have a younger brother, so I noticed that I was the only one that had to wear hearing aids. So that stood out to me.
Anyone else?
I have two brothers and sisters, and they're deaf. Two siblings that are deaf. I learned sign language at a camp, a sign language camp. I think I was 6 or 7, maybe 8 years old, and I went to school and I kept attending this camp. I think by the time I was 9 or 10 years old, I was fluent in sign language. My brother signed with me, and then my sister, who's also deaf, signed with me. I have a sibling, a sister who can hear, she's older, and then a brother and sister who are deaf and can sign. So we all communicate between my parents and my sister and I. We communicate and gesture to each other, and there is a communication within our family. But the fact that we have a sister who can hear, she connects us with our hearing parents. And the fact that we have the other two, the two deaf also that we can sign with.
So can I follow up before someone else asks? So Jose, are you saying that you have siblings that don't sign at all, and so this has impacted your relationship with them?
Yes. My sister and brother who are deaf sign, but my older sister can hear and she does not sign. After the camp, and she saw that I was signing, I tried to sign with her, and I think she took a class or something. My mother did take the class, but she gave up, but my sister continued with learning to sign. I have two deaf sisters. One is older, and the other one is younger. She's only 9 or 10. She has a cochlear implant. So there were the two of us, and I signed and she did it. She seemed quieter and she seemed a little bit more laid back, and she was not able to sign. She was mainstream. She was with hearing people in a regular public school. And then she went to sign camp, and there were 2 or 3 or 4 other deaf people that she could communicate with. And she learned a lot of sign, and I was able to learn from her. And then I learned from her, and then our younger sibling learned from us. I'm the only deaf person in my family. I wasn't able to communicate. My mother did not know what to do, but my mother and aunt went to the Rhode Island School for the Deaf, and they took sign language classes there. And there's one woman who was a teacher from the deaf. Her name was Amy. She used to come to our house, I think it was once a week, and she would teach me sign language and show me pictures, for example, of a ball, and teach me the sign for ball. And my sister also learned sign language, and we were very close, and we would talk to each other in sign language. And we taught our grandparents, so everybody in my family knows basic sign language.
Another follow-up. When did you first meet, if ever, another person that you felt was like you? How old were you, and where did that happen? If you have met someone that you feel is like you, has your identity.
When I was a little boy, I went into the Boston School for the Deaf. My mother was young, she was 17. And that was in Randolph, the Boston School for the Deaf, and now that school has closed down. It's not in existence anymore. So we went around, and nobody there signed. It was forbidden. You were not allowed to sign. And all the kids looked at the teacher, and they all lip-read, and the teachers taught them how to speak. It was very oral, very disciplined in that regard, and really strict. If they saw you signing, then you would get a slap on the wrist with a ruler or a shoe. They take the bottom of their shoe. and smack you with it. So I felt scared. And all the kids, when we played outside with each other, they weren't really signing. It was something different. It was home signs, it was gesturing. And I looked around and I thought, wow, they're all like me. But I wasn't aware enough about the fact that I was deaf or having a deaf identity. I did not have that yet. But as I grew up and I got educated and I developed, I understood who I am and everybody understood who they were. When I was growing up, when my parents found out that I was deaf, they were shocked. They didn't know what to do. The first thing, of course, I think most people have the reaction of, when is my child going to get their hearing back again? And fortunately, my mother met a really good friend at the hospital, and she was talking to another mother about a hearing test when I went for my hearing test. And she talked about this place called Reed's, R-E-A-D-S. And my mom drove over there, and since then I was involved with Reed's and I learned how to sign. And I'm deaf, I just accepted the fact that I'm a deaf person. Explain to the audience what Reed's means. Well, R-E-A-D-S, that is a program to expose children to ASL, and it gives you choices. If you want to go the oral route, they'll support that. If you want to sign, they'll support that. And they put you in a mainstream setting in a public school. And then there's also a self-contained classroom of just deaf students. So you're in both the deaf and the hearing world throughout the school day. Any more? Well, also, when I was maybe in elementary school or finishing up elementary school, I transferred to the Pulaski School in New Bedford, and I really didn't like it there. And then I transferred to the Rhode Island School for the Deaf when I went into middle school, and I stayed there throughout high school. When I was a kid, this was in Chicago, I was the only deaf person. And I looked at the mainstream school and I'm like, why are there no deaf schools around? Why am I here with these people I can't communicate with? It was frustrating to be in the classes. And then later, when I was maybe about 6 or 7 or 8, I was like, oh, there's a school for the deaf. And then I transferred to the Illinois School for the Deaf. And in high school, I attended the Illinois School for the Deaf. And I was surprised that there's so many deaf people, and I met these deaf people that were just like me. And then I traveled to other states, and I saw that there were deaf schools in other states, and I met other deaf people, and I was happy to meet people that were just like me.
I may have mentioned this previously, but I was mainstreamed into the public school setting. I relied on hearing aids from a very early age, which ultimately proved to be ineffective for me and led to me getting the cochlear implant. And shortly after I received the cochlear implant, I was considered a member of what they call the Minuteman Implant Club. And it was at that time that I met other people who have any hearing difficulties.
Have you met other young adults with an implant?
Starting in 2003, that was the first time I ever had any exposure to it.
And I just want to ask first Adam and Jessica to explain, what is Rhode Island School for the Deaf, and what does it look like to be a school for the deaf from young age all the way up
from
high school?
Well, it's been a while and I have a lot of memories from there. Well, basically it's a school for the deaf, right? Everyone that goes there is deaf, and it's from preschool all the way through 12th grade. It's a normal school setting, but there a small enrollment. The total number of students is low. There are teachers who sign. And some students do have implants, some are oral deaf, some are still learning to sign. And there are some accommodations for those students so that they fit in. There's a system called the IEP, Individualized Education Plan, and that accommodates students' needs and it fits what their needs are and their educational plan. So that summarizes it.
And
yeah, what I hadn't said.
I just want to ask Holly if you went to a school for the deaf and what your schooling was like when you first met someone who also had the type of hearing loss that you have. And I'm just going to hand you the microphone.
This time we're going to talk right into it.
A little closer to home.
I didn't go to the school that was for the deaf, but when I was in school, they told me they realized that I couldn't hear you. They sent me to a speech therapist because I wasn't speaking with the rest of the classroom. I spent the last 12 years of school there going to speech therapist for 2 hours a day, learning how to communicate and sound out words, also to read other people's words so that I can talk to the rest of them.
And when was the first time you remember meeting someone who was also a lip reader, as you identify yourself?
Believe it or not, then until my adult life. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
I'm going to follow up. So some of you have already talked about the fact that you sign to communicate and where you learn to sign. So I'm curious to hear from Alex and Holly. Was sign language ever presented as an option for you? Is that something you were ever interested in? What's your experience and feelings about sign language? That hearing people might often think all deaf and hard of hearing people sign. So if you could talk about that.
Well, I think that that's a misconception. Of course, that all deaf people sign. There was certainly an issue that was presented to my parents when they found out that I was deaf at the age of 2. Looking back on it, it would have been nice to know how to sign, but at that point in time, I was too small to make that decision for myself. So my parents, keeping my best interests at heart, they wanted me to be as integrated with the hearing world as I possibly could.
I was never taught sign. I was never taught sign. They didn't have it in the schools when I was a kid. Actually, they didn't come into the public school system to the language, and I was already out of school by quite a few years.
And are you taking sign right now?
Yes.
Why?
Because I feel that I don't fit in the world right now. I feel I'm stuck between not being able to understand people in the human world and not being able to understand people in science.
And I just want to follow up if anyone else has anything to add about when you were included in the decision making as a child in terms of your modality, in terms of signing versus speaking. As Alex just mentioned, if you were included in that IEP process, if you were included in what school you went to, it sounds like Adam might have been included in some of that. Can you talk more about how you may or may not have been included in decisions like that as a child?
The first time that I ever actually was included in any decision-making process was starting in high school. And The reason for that, I believe, is because, most of the time, students in high school, they tend to take their education more seriously, or at least that's what we hope. So it was at that point in time, they felt like they could ask me, what do you need from us to succeed? And I could give them the most well-thought-out answer that I could.
My eyes were first opened at camp. I saw people signing, and that's when I decided I wanted to get more involved in American Sign Language. I was at a mainstream program at Reed's, and there were some deaf people there. I felt it was a little limited, and I said, I wanted to go to camp again. And there were about 150 people there. We interacted with each other. There were various signs, and I stayed with American Sign Language. And my brother decided to go to the American School for the Deaf. And there, it was a school for the deaf, it was a residential program, he decided to stay there. He said, do you want to go? And I said, no, I'd rather be in public school. And my brother asked whether I wanted to stay, and I said, do they have baseball, do they have football? He said, no. I said, no, I'm staying in public school. I want athletics, I want that baseball, I want that football. My brother stayed at the American School for the Deaf, I stayed in the mainstream program. We went down our separate paths, and it all worked out fine. My parents made the decision for me to be educated in the various programs, and that time when I transferred to the Rhode Island School for the Deaf, I felt like I wasn't being exposed to the deaf as much, and I knew there was more out there than the mainstream program had to offer to me. And I decided that I wanted to be transferred to a school, and he said that my mom said that there will be a school for the deaf. She offered me three options to fit the financial issues and transportation issues. The first was American School for the Deaf, the Learning Center, and to Rhode Island School for the Deaf. Now, American School for the Deaf and the Learning Center, I didn't want to go so far because the school district maybe didn't want to pay for that transportation. And so I didn't want to stay in a dorm either. I wanted to be in a home environment and just commute to school. I wasn't used to being in a dorm or a residential setting. And so Rhode Island School for the Deaf was close enough. And I had never had the experience of a school for the deaf. When I did decide to go to Gallaudet University, my parents were supportive, but after a semester, I felt like it was too much and I transferred back home and I attended here.
I have some fun myths to just get rid of for the audience right now. Raise your hand if you drive. Not the audience, the panel. Raise your hand if you've ever had a job and you worked with hearing people and not all deaf people. Raise your hand if you've had a job. Raise your hand if you've played on an athletic team.
Raise your hand if you read Braille.
I do, as a matter of fact. Yeah, Braille. I've been trained to do that. Actually, I did have that experience.
Raise your hand if hearing people screaming at you and talking slowly helps you understand what they're saying.
Not really. I wish.
So let's get those out of the way. All right, so now a personal question you can choose not to ask. I'm curious, in terms of a life partner or practicing towards getting a life partner, when we're talking about girlfriends, boyfriends, husbands, and wives, are you or do you see yourself committing to someone like you, to someone not like you, or it doesn't matter, who you fall in love with, you'll fall in love with?
I'm open-minded to whatever relationship. I have a partner, and he can hear. He's a former student here as well, and now he's working. But when we first met, he had no idea about deafness or sign language or deaf culture. And we informally interacted, and I exposed him to all those things, and he thought it was cool. And he didn't know things about the deaf world, like how we interact with each other and how we communicate, and that we do have our own world. But I've been teaching him things, and he's still, after 2 years, a little awkward and learning, but he really is good with trying to sign, and we have a good relationship because of that.
I should have mentioned this in the beginning, but I actually moved here from Foxborough, home of the Patriots. And the reason I moved down here was mainly because my girlfriend was born and raised here, and we've been together for 4 years now. She can hear. And that kind of relationship was very eye-opening for me, well, for both of us, really. We had to deal with the fact that it was hard for me to talk on the phone, so I had to keep reminding her, you know, I love to hear your voice, but I can't understand you, so you're going to have to text me. But I mean, it's a learning experience for both of us. I'm the only hard of hearing person in my family. So my family went through this learning experience with me. And now I'm going through the same thing with her family.
Well, a few years ago, I met a boy who was able to hear, and he was fascinated with signing, and the relationship developed for 3 or 4 months, but it did have its ups and downs because I didn't think it was a good fit. I thought it would be a better fit for me to be with a deaf person. So a couple of years later, I met Josh through Facebook, and we've been together now for 2 years, and we have a good relationship, and we communicate through sign language. It's great. I grew up with hearing people all over, and really at first I was resistant to a relationship with a deaf person. And then I realized there was a communication issue, that communication is important. So sometimes the hearing person would be speaking and forget about me, and would be at a bar or at a party, and this person's talking and forgetting about me. I'm like, hey, I'm here, don't leave me out. And this happened over and over again. And so we went to a deaf event where I was signing, and she said, well, what are you saying? I said, well, see how it feels? And there was that disconnect often. And finally, I did meet a deaf woman. And we've been together 17 years. We're married. We have 2 kids. We communicate fine. 17 years. Whoops, I almost forgot about that.
And we'll go back to a raise your hand question. I'm doing the up and down, so now we're all laughing. So raise your hand if you're sick of hearing people say, never mind, I'll tell you later.
Oh, I'm sick of it.
Yep.
Has that happened?
That happens plenty of times.
So if we go back to the positive, if you think about hearing people outside of your family or friends, but hearing people you just happen to meet, and you might be the first deaf or hard of hearing or lip reader that they've met, can you think of a time that it went really well? And what did that hearing person just sort of naturally do that made you connect or have a positive experience with them?
I had one. I moved to Fall River from Taunton. I think we had moved a couple of times, but my mother took me to McDonald's. We went up near North Park, and I was playing basketball. I was alone, and my older sister joined this church group, it was a youth group, and they looked at me as a deaf person. My sister said, well, this is my brother, and introduced me to them. And then a few years later, they came to North Park while I was there. And they were like, oh, he's deaf, you know, leave him alone. And they didn't leave me out. If they were doing something, they involved me in what they were doing because they were part of my sister's church group. And so we developed the friendship from there.
So what behavior were they doing that you wish other hearing people did? What did they do?
They really wanted to learn sign language but didn't. But they would like hold my hand and walk around with me. I wish I could teach them sign language, but I didn't either. There was one idol, this person that I absolutely idolized. His name was Chris Herring. He was someone that I looked up to. He was always there for me. He supported me. He taught me so many things. I taught him sign language, and our friendship proceeded from there. And he was so popular, and then people looked up to me because I was with him. So. Where I lived, in the neighborhood where I grew up, there were so many people, kids my age, but they could hear. And then when I moved into that neighborhood, all the neighbors, you know how it is. People get together, they say, hi, how are you? They introduce themselves, they bake you a pie or whatever. And that's how I met these neighbors' children. And we interacted with each other, and it was just normal of how hearing people gesture to deaf people. Like, for example, if you're talking about something, like my grandmother, you know, they'd be hunched over like an old person, you know, this is my grandmother, or they act, you know, they'd act like an old person and gesture. They knew a little bit of sign language. And it was really a nice relationship. We all played with each other and interacted with one another. And I felt this camaraderie with some hearing people. Some can be fine. They say, you know, they can adjust to the fact that you're deaf. And I noticed a lot of deaf people have stories where they say a hearing person will, like, run away from them or avoid them. Some people do have these experiences. But there are plenty of people that are willing to communicate and adapt and try to get to know you. It was really an awesome experience for me in my neighborhood.
So now I'd like to bring you back to the college setting. And I want you to think about a classroom experience you've had or a professor that you've had that has created access in a way in which allowed you to really learn the material and feel included in the classroom. And describe what that professor did.
Well, I speak directly to the teacher about accommodations, and I noticed that a teacher who is attuned to what I need and waits for the interpreter to get the message and sign it to me, or the other way around, get my message and speak it to the teacher. I've seen that a teacher that participates and is in tune to my needs is effective.
Other?
My first year at the University of UMass Dartmouth, I did not have any access, and I had to go to the Mass Commission for the Deaf and Hard of Hearing and put in some requests, and I didn't have access to tutoring, and it was very frustrating to me for the year that I was there. And I had friends help me, and I got notes from them, and there was really no access, so I withdrew from there, and I went to work. And then a friend said, BCC has access, they have interpreters, they provide you communication access and supports, and I was so relieved when I came here, because this is a great community, and I really hope the word gets out there about BCC and the accessibility options here. I want to add just one more thing. From my experience at Gallaudet University, which is completely different than here, at Gallaudet, they have everything set up. Teachers can sign, they're deaf teachers. And I was anxious about coming here because I did not know what to expect. I'm like, is it going to be an interpreter? And so far I've had no complaints about accommodations, and everything I need is provided for me. And I feel like everything's set, and I don't feel like I don't have any support. It's really been a wonderful experience here.
So now, can you tell me what it feels like when you're in a classroom where the teacher's introducing vocabulary and emphasizes what it sounds like and how that's the most effective way to learn? When you sit in a classroom, and so many faculty are used to teaching through speaking, and they introduce, let's say, new vocabulary, whether it be a reading class, or a medical language class, or a writing class, they're introducing new vocabulary, and they try to help you learn how to memorize spelling it, or what it means. And their one method of teaching the class how to do it is by how it sounds. How does that make you feel?
Oh, it's tough. Because in American Sign Language, we use signs and we watch those signs. In English, it's difficult with the words because I don't feel like I'm benefiting from that sound approach. I sign in American Sign Language, and it's really difficult for me to write in English, and it's difficult for me to get vocabulary and read because most of the teachers, they talk about, oh, it sounds like this, and they're doing these things with all these sounds, and it's a little too much for me. If you break it down, it's a little easier for me to understand. Okay. Growing up, my mother always encouraged me to read. And it really helped me a lot with English. And I still struggle, but I don't have as much difficulty, I think, as if I hadn't read. And I do have issues of how to write things, but reading I seem to be fine with. But writing, like for example, my mind is wanting to write it as an ASL sentence, and so how I interpret it into English is a process. But taking in the English through reading, I understand it and I can interpret it into ASL, but ASL back into English is a little more difficult for me.
Please, thank you. Thanks.
That when you say the word, they're not even there. Or other times that a certain letter would sound like a different letter than it's in the word. So I find that really difficult.
And what can a teacher do to help make the lesson more accessible for you? Or what have you done outside of the classroom with extra work and extra time to make that learning experience work?
Tutoring, or talking to the teacher after class and asking questions, and sometimes asking my parents what to do and how they would say it. And for example, what are their strategies for learning and memorizing things?
I have gone to the professor and to speak to her so that I could learn how she says certain words and how. I also asked her that she needs to say the word, the one letter from there, so that I could learn to say them properly. It was a little difficult because she doesn't speak very clear according to me. There were some letters that I had to figure out how she actually says them, so that I can figure out what she's saying for the word.
So I have a question that I know the answer to, but the audience doesn't. I'm curious if anyone on the panel wants to share if they've taken ASL classes or deaf studies classes, and what they thought before the first day about what they could possibly learn, and what they came out at the end with. Was there something new to learn, or did you already know everything? Or are you in classes now?
Well, for example, from the hearing perspective of deaf people, I'm like, oh, I didn't realize that hearing people think that about us. And I mean, it's not really bad stuff, but sometimes I think it's funny, actually, because I know way back when in the 50s, people believed that deaf people couldn't drive. But I couldn't believe that people still think that some deaf people don't drive. I was surprised. I was surprised to hear that. So that's just an example of something that I learned in my class. I decided to take Deaf Studies with Human Services, and I went to my advisor, Sandy Lager, and I said, why should I take ASL? I'm deaf. She said, no, come join the class. She said, no, come join the class. And so I went to the class, and I have learned a lot. I learned about classifiers. I didn't know about classifiers. And of course, I realized, you know, when my children were growing up and learning to sign, they were using classifiers. So I just did learn a lot of different things about American Sign Language. So, like history, things about history, and I learned more about deaf history, so that's been interesting.
We're just dealing with access again. Anybody else want to talk about classes?
Jose took my idea.
So outside of your identity as a deaf person, a hard of hearing person, a lip reader, I can imagine that often, especially in college classrooms, that part of your identity becomes what people focus on. So who else are you? Are you married? Are you into any hobbies? Are you an avid book reader? What's your favorite movie? Who are you besides a deaf, hard of hearing, or lip reading person?
Let me think about that. Okay, well,
I had to tell Jose who he was.
Sorry, you go ahead, Jose. Okay. I'm involved in the deaf community. I do bowling. And also there is a deaf basketball tournament that I'm involved in. And I'm involved with the committee for the bowling tournaments. Oh, there's so many things I'm involved with. Fantasy football. We have a deaf group that does that. And I'm involved with a church. We meet every Monday night and we have basketball there. Oh, there's so many groups that I'm involved in, I can't think of them all. I'm involved with a basketball league for the deaf. There are a lot around. And I'd like to join football, but there are no deaf leagues around here. And there was this one person who set up a football league, and that should be getting off the ground soon. Let's see, what else? Honestly, most of the time I do join hearing leagues, and that doesn't bother me. I love basketball, and when I was about 6 or 7, my mother put me in a hearing league, and I played in that league, and then at the Rhode Island School for the Deaf, I played basketball, and I played here 2 or 3 years ago, and when I did sign up, my coach said, oh, a deaf person, that's interesting, and they realized that I was a wicked good player, and I was hoping that the team would set up signs for various plays. And during the games, we had no problem. We used signs for various plays, and it didn't bother anyone. Well, I am very interested in art and graphic design and reading. I'm not a person who's isolated. It's hard for me to explain. Okay. Well, for me, I'm an artist. I like to paint abstract paintings. I like photography. I like taking photographs of people and nature. I like to travel. And I like going out to eat in restaurants. So I do all the normal things that hearing people do as well. There is no difference with me. Well, same thing. That's what I was trying to say. I'm no different than a hearing person. Ms. Fisher said, well, that's what I was trying to say, Jim, that you were explaining that I'm no different than a hearing person. I feel the same way.
Holly, any hobbies, interests, favorite movie?
But do you also have children or grandchildren?
I have two and two grandchildren.
They keep you quite busy. Are they hearing or are they deaf?
They're all hearing.
I actually have fraternal twins, twin girls. They're 12, and soon they will be teenagers. Come February 2nd, they will be 13. I'm in big trouble with those two. I'm trying to manage the whole attitude, puberty thing. And most of the time we text each other and I go and say hello and they're like, oh, I'm focusing on the computer and technology and texting my friends. It wasn't like before, they're like, oh, hey, daddy. That's gone. They focus on the technology and their friends and things that normal teenagers do, and I seem to be isolated away from them. But that's teenagers.
So I'm just going to pull back on some technology for a minute, but oh, please.
No, go ahead. Okay, well, I have two children. They are actually deaf. I have a girl and a boy. They're 16 and 11. And I have two sisters who are deaf. And you have a wife, Jose. Yes, yes, my wife. My deaf wife, hello. You forgot about me, Jose. I already told them that I have a wife. We've been married for 17 years. You missed that part. All right, so let me make sure.
So I'm just going to pull back on technology. One, I'm going to ask if anyone still uses a TTY, and if not, what do you use and what is it, including a CapTel phone all the way to a video phone. Can you just talk a little bit more about how that makes you really able to call or talk to anyone you'd like to?
I text. Previous generations used TTYs. Now there's much different technology. Video phones and 711, you can use that on your cell phone. There are computers and the internet, and there's so much more access now than there was ever before. And TTY, that's an old technology. People use a video phone now, or they use this thing called the N-Touch. And I have an iPhone 4, and I use a Z4 on there, and Sorensen Video Relay Service on there, so I can contact people through my video phone. When I had a TTY, I couldn't stand it, because I was so frustrated, because you had to know how to spell English words, and you had to type back and forth to people, and sometimes somebody would be going on, and you couldn't interrupt them, and there was this, like, printer paper, and it was so overwhelming. But now, with the video phone, it's great. I can sign to the person I'm speaking to or sign through an interpreter. On TTY, you couldn't see people's faces, facial expressions, but on the video phone, you see them. It's like being in the same room with them. And the video phone is like watching TV almost. People are moving around and you take, there's turn taking. It's like having a real conversation with the teacher while you're reading, and these words are coming across the screen. Sometimes it's boring, you can't interrupt. You can walk away and do some cooking while the words are going on the screen, then you come back and it's like, yeah, okay, fine, bye-bye, and end the conversation. You rip the paper and you read it and you go, oh, this is what the person said. Okay, boring. I don't know if you're going to criticize me, but there are some positives and negatives to everything. Now, the positive of the TTY is it helped with the English language. Now, with the video phone, the negative is you're signing and you're not learning any English. So that's my opinion. It was fine with me typing because it helped me use English and improve my grammar, and you know, it was a pain in the butt with the GA and the SK stuff. I mean, signing is better because you can communicate and you have that communication access, but it is detrimental to the English language. Well, I agree with Jose, but with the TTY, sometimes you miss things because people are typing so fast. I'm like, whoa, 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 whoa. Let me go back and see what they said. It was such a waste.
Let me interrupt. So, you would rather order a pizza through your TTY relay than video relay?
Video. No. Adam's saying no. Jose's saying, oh, obviously, a video phone for ordering a pizza. You don't use a TTY for that.
Josh
says he likes the video phone.
Why is that obvious? The audience doesn't know. Why would that be better?
Well, with the TTY, it takes you half an hour to order a pizza. With the video phone, it takes you a minute to order a pizza. That's why.
Holly, how do you order a pizza?
Actually, the other
two,
I have my kids on.
But recently, what did you just get that you can use?
I get a cap telephone.
And how does that work?
We have it set on the other end, it's typed so that I can read it. But what comes to my half is I actually speak into the phone and communicate to the person. And you don't need to dial a special number like you do that. You need to dial a special number.
So we are going to stop with our guided questions. We hope we've given you a taste of some of the diversity that is sitting in front of you. And we wanted to give some time for the audience to ask their own questions from anyone willing to order or a specific answer or a specific person on the panel.
I think it's in Rochester.
NTID.
Yeah.
NTID?
Oh, yeah. I went to NTID for one semester. I wasn't happy with it because the students weren't focusing on English and nouns and verbs and grammar. I like it much better here.
That's my question, why they came back. Because I, you know, the college experience, more freshman homesickness, overwhelming that alone, never mind. And that's why I was asking who went there. Besides the overwhelmness, you know.
Great question. So for those of you who went to a deaf college and came back, and to those of you who just came to BCC, why wasn't a deaf college a fit for you? Why did you choose BCC?
Okay. I was a Gallaudet one semester, and I did attend classes, but it was overwhelming with how many people there were there, and I had a lot of friends. My social life was booming, and there were a lot of distractions because in DC there were so many places to go and see and so many attractions and so much to do and so many experiences to gain, and I realized that it affected my education. And so I decided I needed to focus on my education a bit more, so I came back home. And I didn't know what to do. I didn't know where to go. Should I go to UMass? Should I go to BCC? And I did some research about the disability services at various colleges and universities. Do they provide interpreters or not? And so this seemed like a nice place. And I thought it was a good more flexible than Gallaudet. In Gallaudet, it was a bit more strict about what you needed to do freshman year and the requirements. And there were some things that I didn't feel were a fit to me. And so I left there. But here, you're a bit more flexible. You can pick your classes. You can pick the classes that you want and things that relate to my interests. So that's why I came here. And of course, the services, the disability services are great, and I love the interpreting services. I was raised in a public school, and I didn't go to Gallaudet or NTID. My brother went to Gallaudet. I did go to visit, and I saw so many deaf people. And there were courses, but to me, it still didn't feel like it was a fit. I was used to being in a hearing environment in a public school, and I couldn't detach from that. And it was so far, I didn't want to stay in the dorms. I wanted to be close to home and close to my family. My brother was fine because he was used to being at the American School for the Deaf, which is a residential school, and he was there, and then he went to Gallaudet. I was used to being around my family, my siblings, and it's sort of like you're used to, right, being in a public school, you're home with your family after school, and I like that.
Okay, other questions? Yes.
I'm interested in the opinion, your personal opinion about people, hearing people, who try to sign with you. Do you like that, or do you find it frustrating, or do you rather them just, you just read their lips, or do you not know how to read lips? What are your feelings?
Well, I can read lips a little bit, but my preference is to write back and forth. But if someone's learning sign language, then yes, I can indulge them in a conversation. But if they're asking so many questions and they overwhelm me, I feel like, okay, back off, that's enough. But if it's a nice conversation, then that's fine. I don't want to share all my information in one conversation. That's why I prefer to take it slowly and build on a relationship. It depends on, really, if you're speaking clearly or using some body language and facial expressions, I can get what you're saying. Now, if you're assertive and you want to learn sign language, then I can teach you some signs. Now, if you continue coming up to me, I could continue teaching you some sign language.
So do you welcome ASL students on campus if they see you coming up to you and going, hi, my name is Bob. Is that okay? Or does it depend on your mood?
Yeah, it's fine. I welcome it. I'm very welcoming. And it's important that the person is not really nervous. I go, why are you so nervous? Sign to me, that's fine. Have some confidence in your signing. Well, we're really happy if students are learning sign language. We are very welcoming. We're accommodating that way. Well, if a person comes up to me and is like, oh, I'm learning sign language, I go, that's great. I mean, I feel like we're two people, we can have a conversation, and it does make me feel good that I'm communicating with someone. Now, sometimes deaf people are isolated, and they don't want to deal with other people, and they don't want to approach other people, and they're a little tentative about it. But I like people that come up to me, because we're all people, and we all want to communicate. And also, from my experience, from being in a hearing family, I know a lot of friends who are completely deaf, like the generations of deaf people, and of course there's a different perspective on that. They feel like, whoa, what are you doing coming up and talking to me? You know, they feel like hearing people are beneath them. And sometimes I go, what's the matter with you? They're just learning, they're enthusiastic, they'd like to know sign language, and just, you know, teach them or help them along, and it will influence how they feel about deaf people. They want to know about your culture and everything. And some people are really opinionated about their resistance to interacting with hearing people. I'm not.
Does that answer your question? Other questions? Yes.
You had a magic
wand and you could change one thing about BCC to make it a better environment for you, what would that one thing be?
That's a good question. I don't have any issues with the people here or anything. Jim says, sometimes I feel, I don't know.
Are the panelists feeling nervous about...
All right, I have something to say. All right. I'm trying to figure out that answer. There was no community college, and now that we have such a successful successful accommodations here, maybe the word will spread and it'll go to other colleges.
But be brave. Come on. What's not working at BCC without naming names or offices, and what could you fix if you could to make it better for you and for other deaf, hard of hearing, or lip readers? What's something that would make it better?
Well, I did experience something with a particular teacher where the teacher was a bit standoffish. Oh, you're deaf? Mm-hmm. And the teacher acted like I didn't exist. And later on, the teacher did get used to me and was a bit more inclusive. And that was good, but I wish the teacher would have been like that from the beginning. What about you? Do you have something to say, Josh? I think you have something to say. About basketball? No? Right? Wouldn't you wish something changed about basketball that they would understand about the deaf? No? All right, forget it.
How does this follow up then? If there's a new building built on campus, which there may be, will be, and the deaf students got to design it, how would it look different from the buildings we have on the campus now if it was the way that deaf people and hard of hearing people and lip readers needed it to be?
Oh, add more access, yeah, have that spread, deaf services and... The building would have access in the sense that you could see strobe lights, there would be a video phone, everything would be very visual. You mean like at Gallaudet? The SLC building at Gallaudet and that is specific to Gallaudet University. They set up this building, this design, and there are some classrooms in it, but there are also offices for providing services. There are some rooms where you can use a video phone in private. There are sort of like telephone booths, but they're for video phones. And there are TVs around, and it provides information about the weather and events and news, and it's captioned. But here, we have some TV monitors, but they're not captioned. And they should look at the SLC at Gallaudet as a model for designing a deaf-friendly building. And more deaf staff would be great.
Why?
You know,
is that
more
important?
Deaf staff. Because hearing people tend to oppress the deaf. And you can show that deaf people can do the same job the hearing people can do. And also to add to that, it would help deaf staff who are hearing staff here to say, oh, a deaf person could be a teacher and a professor, and it'll sort of be a learning opportunity for them. Because if you don't have deaf staff, then the hearing staff aren't exposed to the fact that deaf people are able to do these things. And then word will spread, and it'll be more an awareness of deaf people's abilities.
Other questions? Is there other things that hearing people do that you wish they wanted? I remember in my deaf studies class, in deaf culture, my teacher pointed out that we don't have to stop when you're in the middle of an interpreter. And I didn't know, yeah, I used to do that, and I didn't offend anybody. But things like that, that hearing people do, that you wish they wanted, you just like, hey, you don't have to do it, it's okay.
Silly hearing people behavior.
If deaf people are talking to each other, then basically I have like eyes in the back of my head because I can feel you staring at me if I'm talking with someone. We have just this feeling. We have this sense that someone's staring at us and it'll be distracting. It's really annoying.
So don't stare, okay? What else?
Sometimes, if there are two people talking, sometimes people will sort of duck under. That's distracting. It's like, whoa, okay, somebody just passed by. Or they'll walk around, or they'll stop in the middle, and it's like, oh, what's going on? Oh, I don't know what to do. It's like, go on by, just walk right by. It's happened to me here, it's happened to me outside of here as well. And many times when I'm talking to another deaf person, we're signing to each other, and then the person will just stand there. I'm like, what are you doing? Just walk around. I said, what's going on? What are you staring at? What do you want? They're like, oh, no. And then they walk around. So they're like, they're taken aback by what's happening. Or they'll wave like that at me to walk by, and I'm like, what? What are they doing? They don't need to do that. They can just walk right on through. Yeah. I'm sick of people saying, oh, he can't hear, look at him. Oh, it's because he's deaf, that's another thing. Well, you're hearing. So stop that, oh, because he's deaf. And don't say, oh, because of this or because of that. Don't point it out. It's negative. Like, if you go to the mall or you go to a restaurant or a McDonald's or whatever, I am sick of people coming up to the cashier and being like, going up to the cashier and saying, I'm deaf, and they look at me and they don't know what to do. Like, use your common sense, get out a piece of paper and have me write to you, or you take out a piece of paper from the register and have me write on it. And I'm like, I need a pen to write on the paper? And so then they get a pen and then I can write down my order. It's just really awkward when people don't use their common sense. I'm sick of that. Yeah, and I hate it when I go to McDonald's or Burger King and the person is at the counter, I say, I'm deaf. I'm like, I'm deaf, hello, pointing to my ear. And then finally they'll write something. I'm like, all right, thank you. Thanks for the piece of paper. Or some people will be like, I can't write. Another person will have to write you. I'm like, this is your job. This is awkward. Well, sometimes when I go to get like coffee at Sip and Dip, I can't go through the drive-thru, or I will go through the drive-thru, and I give them a piece of paper. They're like, you need to go to the microphone. I'm like, read the paper. And they're like, oh. And I make my coffee. Well, when I go to a restaurant, I'm having a nice dinner, I'm sitting there with someone, and the waitress will come over, and there's a menu, right? And I'll point to something in the menu, I'll close the menu and give it back to her. But the problem is, like at McDonald's or Burger King, like you can't go through the drive-thru, because when you go around, you can't talk into the microphone. You have to go to the window and give them your order. And at that time, they punch it in, and you pay, and then they give you your food. Right. It's better than going into the building and having to get your food. That's a waste of time. Right.
Other questions?
Time for a couple more?
Yeah.
What would be the best way
that a hearing, that a deaf person would want a hearing for the, wait, I answered that wrong, I'm sorry. What would be the best way for a deaf, a hearing person to learn from a deaf person? What do they think would be the best way?
To learn sign language? Or to just learn about?
I guess a hearing person to, understand that. What do they think would be the best way, say for me, to learn about that? To approach them or to try to learn from them?
So if a hearing person wants to learn about
a deaf person,
how what's your advice? Yeah. What should they do?
Tell them to listen.
It's simple.
Ask them.
How do I, like for example here, they provide deaf studies programs and things on deaf culture and sign language classes. Take those. And if you can't take those, then just ask the person directly and ask them to teach you and expose you to things. Or maybe bring them to like the Deaf Expo or some kind of deaf event or a deaf club and various things where you can meet other deaf people and learn about things and be involved.
My experience has been like a hearing person can't get involved with a deaf, say, club or event. It's like five, it's deaf only.
Well, I won't speak for the deaf community, but I don't know one local deaf event that bans hearing people, so.
No, I don't either. No, I disagree. That's not true.
Yeah, I would say get on.
Tell me where and I'll go.
I mean, there are some events, I think it's clear in advertisement when an event put on by deaf people for deaf people is really just for them. It's clear in the advertising. You know, you wouldn't show up, or it's just clear common sense going to, you know, you don't show up at a deaf funeral because that's your way to get exposed. You know, but if there's a deaf bowling league, you know, maybe you can't participate and have a team, but you can observe. And I see, instead, often what happens with hearing students is the attitude they're feeling is based on the behavior that is happening. So you're at a deaf bowling game because you want to meet deaf people and use your sign, but you're sitting in the corner talking to your friend or texting on a phone, and then deaf people are like, you're in my house now. Why are you here being rude? Get out. And that's different than hearing people aren't invited. So that might have been some of what you're seeing, but I would recommend going on the BCC Deaf Studies Facebook page if you're on Facebook. I post events all the time that hearing students are welcome to go to with deaf community members there. I think we have time for one more question, if there's one more question. Well, thank you so much, Pannel. I can't thank you enough. Don't take off. We have a token of thank you for you, so please don't run out. I'm hoping that the audience has learned a little something and that now that they have faces of deaf, hard of hearing, and lip-reading students on campus, they'll be more aware and more sensitive and put on a friendly face and a glow when they see you on campus. Thank you, everybody.